The rising hostility between Saudi Arabia and Iran is creating concerns that the Middle East mess could actually get worse. The two countries represent two large and conflicting sects of Islam, and some fear this situation could actually lead to war. Joining us here in the studio is CBN News Chief International Correspondent Gary Lane. In Washington, our terrorism analyst Eric Stackelbeck, and in Jerusalem, our Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell. Chris, let's start with you. What is this confrontation between Saudi Arabia and Iran say about the current state of the Middle East?
Well, Lori, what it says is that there's actually this historic confrontation coming up between Sunni powers and the Shiite world. And there's really a Shiite crescent forming all the way from Tehran and Beirut, in Tehran and Iran, and all the way to Beirut and Lebanon with Hezbollah. Now, the Shiites and the Sunnis, they hate each other more than they hate Israel, if you can believe that. And what's happening right now is this huge confrontation. One wild card in all of this is that Russia is actually coming in on the Shiite side of things. So I think what we see here, what's going to happen with this confrontation, is going to determine in a great way what's going to happen to the future of the Middle East.
It's a real powder keg. How does Israel fit into this new state of affairs in the Middle East?
Well, believe it or not, Israel really comes down in the Sunni camp, and they would seem to be not an official alliance with Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Jordan, but an unofficial alliance because both the Sunni powers and Israel see Iran as an existential threat, and they both feel betrayed by this U.S. brokered peace deal, or Iranian nuclear deal, with Iran. And so they see a potential nuclear Iran as an existential threat. And so unofficially, Iran, they see them as an enemy, and they're seeing themselves as unofficial allies against a nuclear Iran.
A very complicated situation. Gary, what do you foresee happening next? Is it possible that war could actually break out between Saudi Arabia and Iran?
Well, perhaps not in the short term, but in the long term, yes, that's a real possibility. In the short term, if you listen to what some of the experts are saying, and we listened to a man by the name of Aaron David Miller, he's with the Wilson Center in Washington, D.C., and he said what we can expect possibly is an emboldened Iran, Iran fomenting perhaps uprisings, more protests in Saudi Arabia, in Bahrain, and then perhaps, Lori, even insurgencies in both of those countries. And if that were to happen, maybe the oil fields would catch on fire or be set ablaze, and that could lead to a greater conflict, a war, a direct war between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and higher oil prices.
And we see the Sunnis and the Shiites battling each other. Remind us about what's at stake here.
Well, as Chris had mentioned, the Sunnis, of course, Saudi Arabia, they're Wahhabi Sunni Muslims, and they're aligned with Turkey and also other Sunni Muslims. And on the other side of this, you would see Iran with Hezbollah, with the Assad regime in Syria, and also with Russia. But those are Shia Muslims. And so you see this war that is actually being played out, proxy wars between Saudi Arabia and Iran, Shia against Sunni, right now in Syria and in Yemen.
Eric, we want to know more about Nimr al-Nimr, the cleric who was executed in Saudi Arabia. Was he a peaceful human rights advocate or worse?
Well, Lori, to hear his allies in Tehran, in Beirut with Hezbollah, in Iraq, to hear them tell it he was just a peaceful human rights activist, which was clear is that he was leading protests in the eastern half of Saudi Arabia, Lori, which is has a large Shiite population. Again, this whole Sunni-Shia divide and civil war we're talking about. Nimr al-Nimr was a prominent Shiite cleric. He was heavily involved in these anti-government protests in eastern Saudi Arabia, in particular back in 2011. That really seems to be the trigger for why he was arrested, Lori, by Saudi authorities. He's been arrested several times over the past few years for continuing to protest against the Saudi royal family and its policies in eastern Saudi Arabia. So the Saudis say he's a terrorist, the Iranians say he's a hero, and that the Saudis will face divine judgment for executing him. So the plot thickens in this Sunni-Shia civil war with this execution.
Indeed it does. And in addition to Nimr al-Nimr, Eric, the Saudis also executed a number of al-Qaeda members on the same day. What do we know about them?
Yeah, over 40 al-Qaeda members, Lori. These were predominantly Saudi citizens, various links to al-Qaeda. One of the men executed carried out an attack back in 2014 that seriously wounded a Western journalist. So typical of the al-Qaeda activity we've seen inside Saudi Arabia over the past several years. Look, it's interesting, Lori. We've talked about this here on CBN News. The Saudi ideology, this Wahhabi radical Islamic ideology, is really what has driven al-Qaeda and ISIS. Yet now they're turning their guns against the Saudi government because they believe the Saudi government is too pro-Western. It's an ally of America. It's got covert ties to Israel in their view. So it's kind of a case of radical Islam coming back to bite the Saudi royal family when we're talking about al-Qaeda and ISIS in the royal kingdom.
Well, Gary, we saw the Obama administration condemn the execution of Nimr al-Nimr, and then the Iranians responded aggressively. If the Iranians respond even more aggressively, as it appears they might, how might the Obama administration respond to that?
Well, that's a good question, because you know that many of the Obama administration critics are saying the Obama administration is partially responsible for this current situation because of the Iranian nuclear deal. The Iranians were given $150 billion when those sanctions were lifted, and they're going to use some of that money to flex their muscles, so to speak, to embolden their supporters in Yemen and rebels there, and also perhaps cause problems in Saudi Arabia and the UAE. So the administration critics are saying they don't expect much more out of this administration. If it goes to a war, then it'll likely, we'll see the Americans on the sidelines.
And finally, Chris, you are in the Middle East, and this is a very tense situation. It's clearly escalating, and it affects everyone throughout the entire world. What do you think should be done?
Well, I think, first of all, Christians should be praying about what's happening here in the Middle East, because it does affect everyone. We talked about possible oil prices going, could be a larger U.S. Intervention here in the region. So it does affect almost everyone here in the Middle East, so certainly pray. And I would think if we had a stronger U.S. administration, it would make a big difference. And I think the weakness of the Obama administration, and not only that, but also tipping the scales sort of in the Iranian Shiite axis, I think that's really created some of this problem right now. And I think we're going to have to wait probably for a new administration and a little over a year to see any changes in that kind of U.S. policy. And just to remind people what's going on, some people may not know about the Sunni-Shiite idea. It just goes back to the very beginning of Islam. Over 1,300 years ago, there was a dispute between Muslims. Who should succeed Muhammad? The Sunnis believed it should come from the Islamic community. The Shiites believed it should come from his family. And ever since then, there's been this animosity. And it's brewing right now. It's percolating. It's starting to boil here in the Middle East. And it's going to have a major impact on the future, not only the Middle East, but around the world.
Well, it's a very serious, a very critical situation that's rapidly changing. And of course, we'll keep following it as events dictate. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us.